Hi everyone, I am Nicolas Merchant, PhD candidate on the Social Neuroscience and Cognition program at Adolfo Ibáñez University in Chile. And today, I'm going to offer you a method for designing probabilistic category learning tasks and discuss why this is important. This work is done in collaboration with my supervisor, Sergio Chagno. The contents of this presentation are as follows. First, a brief introduction about category learning paradigms, followed by a discussion regarding the type of feedback in a learning environment. We will then present our materials and method, where we will show you our most recent probabilistic categorization task, together with a step-by-step instruction for a task design. Then, you will see some preliminary results obtained with the paradigm, and we will finally conclude with a discussion of our findings and a few future ideas. As we all know, categorization is the ability to classify different objects or events into categories. This is often considered essential for survival and a key component of the cognitive system. A common procedure to study how humans learn to classify objects is the category learning task. In this task, a standard procedure is to create a stimuli by combining binary valued features. With n features, it is possible to create 2 to the nth stimuli spanning all possible features combinations. Subjects have to learn that certain combinations are members of category A and others are not, or that certain combinations are members of category A and others of category B. In most of these category learning procedures, feedback is provided on a trial-by-trial basis. At least, two different approaches to feedback are possible. In deterministic feedback, each feature combination is always a member of one of the categories. Hence, perfect performance is possible. In contrast, in probabilistic feedback, each feature combination belongs to a category with probability less than 1. Thus, perfect performance is highly unlikely. Notably, the use of deterministic feedback has been dominant in the literature. The use of probabilistic feedback is much less frequent. We have identified two potential problems stemming from the predominant use of deterministic feedback. The first problem is a possible lack of generalizability of findings, and the second problem is the arguably low ecological validity on deterministic feedback. The following is an illustration of lack of generalizability. A relevant finding of category learning experiments that use deterministic feedback is that people who are trying to learn to classify tend not to learn inter-feature correlations. It is often argued that to learn inter-feature correlations, subjects need to learn by inference. However, Little and Lewandowski show that using probabilistic feedback on a classification task thus promotes inter-feature correlations, just like it occurs in an inference task. Thus, it is possible that some conclusions of category learning research are conditional on deterministic feedback being used, and that deterministic feedback results fail to generalize under probabilistic feedback conditions. Regarding the ecological validity limitation, it is likely that natural learning conditions are more like probabilistic feedback than like deterministic feedback conditions. In natural environments, people may need to integrate feedback from different sources, which may not be fully consistent, for example, having multiple teachers. Similarly, the teaching signal itself may be inconsistent, for example, having an imprecise teacher. We believe that the relative lack of research using probabilistic feedback procedures is due to researchers not having a flexible procedure for designing probabilistic feedback category learning experiments. For example, in the Little and Lewandowski procedure, it is apparent that they took their deterministic feedback condition and turned into probabilistic feedback condition by changing the probability of each exemplar. That is, instead of an exemplar belonging to category A with probability equal to 1, in the probabilistic feedback condition, it belonged to category A with probability equal to 0.75. Basically, probabilities are assigned to complete feature combinations, and individual feature probabilities are only derived. For experimental control, one will want a procedure that can flexibly combine feature probability choices with whole stimulus probabilities. A well-researched probabilistic feedback procedure is the weather prediction task. In this task, subjects are presented with combinations of tarot cards, and they have to learn to use them to predict the weather. To compute the probability of the outcome given each individual card, a very specific set of cards combination and outcome probabilities have to be chosen. It is likely that, for experimental control, researchers will want a procedure that can flexibly combine feature probability choices with whole stimulus probabilities. In What's Next, we will present a probabilistic feedback design procedure which can be flexibly used to determine the probability of the category given its feature and its feature combinations. We call this procedure the probabilistic prototype distortion task. For testing the prototype distortion task, or PPD, we recruited 36 participants and implemented a 3x3 design. As I said earlier, the PPD allows the flexibility of combining the probability of the category given a particular feature with the overall feature combination probabilities. In short, the PPD is a mixture between a classical prototype distortion task and probabilistic feedback. To implement the PPD, two prototypical categories are created, C and M, due to the response keys we use. We use ceremonial symbols similar to those reported in the literature, which are composed of three spheres. Each sphere can adopt one of the two possible values, 1 or minus 1. The category C prototype is defined by the 1-1-1 combination. Using effect coding, we combined every possible feature state to obtain a total of 8 exemplars. To assign probabilities to exemplars, we use the logistic function along with the effect coding mentioned before, where C is a sensitivity parameter, beta 0 is the equation constant, and beta 1, 2, and 3 are the feature weights. In this equation, each feature has an individual feature weight that we can flexibly determine. For each exemplar, the probability computed by the equation tells the researcher the corresponding probability of the exemplar belonging to the category. For our experiments, we created three different conditions, AB, BC, and CA, that differentially weighted features in each specific combination. For example, in condition AB, feature 1 is the most diagnostic feature. Feature 2 contributes less to classification probabilities, and feature 3 has no diagnosticity at all. You can see the prototypical ceremonial symbols that we use in the task. Just a reminder, the visual properties of the stimuli can be whichever each researcher wants. The experimental procedure is as follows. The PPD, as any other classification task, has two phases, training and testing. During training, participants have to classify if the presented exemplar belonged into one of the two categories, category C or M. Feedback was provided on a trial-by-trial basis, and for correct responses, the word correct appears in green on the screen for 1.5 seconds. For incorrect responses, a red incorrect appears on the screen. The training phase was composed of three blocks with 80 trials each, 10 trials for each exemplar. In the transfer phase, subjects had to rate each feature combination using a similarity scale with 8 points. Feedback was not provided during this phase. Our training results showed that participants in AB condition achieved a mean accuracy of 58%, 63% in the condition BC and 62% in condition CA. In none of these conditions did subjects approach optimal performance, which was set at 77%. A factorial 3x3 ANOVA revealed a main effect of block and a non-significant interaction between block and condition. These results suggest that there was a learning effect across blocks in every condition. Planned contrast revealed significant differences between block 1 and 2 and between block 1 and 3. Additionally, we compare our classification predictions given by the logistic function with training accuracy across every exemplar, We average accuracy in block 3 for every exemplar and in each condition. This analysis shows that most of the subjects had learned the classification criterion by block 3. As you can see in the figure, in red, the feedback probabilities obtained by the logistic function, and in blue are the empirical average performance. For transfer data, we implemented an individualized multiple regression method. In short, this method allows us to obtain the relative feature weight implied in a set of category membership or similarity ratings. Please see our preceding paper for further details. Because individualized regression equations yield coefficients for single properties, these coefficients can then be used as individual data points reflecting the contribution of each predictor variable to the ratings. With this in consideration, you can see in the figure that each condition behaves similarly. As the figure shows, in each condition, coefficient weights are larger for those features that have graded weights. If you see, feature weight equal to 2.5 yields higher coefficient value, while feature weight equal to 1 yields a lesser value, and feature weight equal to 0 approaches to 0. The same pattern is found in the other two conditions. In the current work, we showed why it is relevant for category learning experiments to use a probabilistic feedback design. Furthermore, we presented a new probabilistic task called the prototype distortion task, which allows us to flexibly manipulate the probability of the category given its feature combinations. Finally, our results suggest that subjects achieve a categorization performance that is consistent with probabilities defined by the logistic function. Some future ideas are worth mentioning. Most importantly, the procedure we discussed for designing the PPD task can be used to flexibly set any desired probabilities depending on researchers' requirements. Also importantly, our method will allow researchers to directly contrast the deterministic feedback and probabilistic feedback in the same task, with the same stimuli and with a whole range of probabilities, ranging from total uncertainty to total certainty. The possibility of parametrically exploring the procedure's parameters will allow answering new questions, such as how much randomness will make a classification task unlearnable, how much non-randomness is necessary for subjects to function as in deterministic environments, and how well do deterministic feedback results generalize to probabilistic feedback conditions. Thank you. Please give us your questions or comments regarding our work in the live Q&A.